braking, collision avoidance, traction control, etc. using sensors. Speed of a car is sensed by a sensor. At homes, we are using energy and water use monitoring. The operation of an air conditioner is controlled by a sensor. Heater level is controlled by a sensor. An oven temperature is controlled by a sensor. Even in our mobile phones, we have two number of sensors. Automated appliances and lighting control, we are using sensors. For safety purpose, we are using sensors for roads, bridges, and homes. So the sensors and transducers are unavoidable in our day-to-day life. Let me start with an example of public addressing system, that is a sound system. It's a simple example which I want to show you before starting my class. It contains a microphone here, which converts sound waves into electrical signal. In the next section, there is an amplifier. The purpose of this amplifier is to amplify the signal coming from the microphone to a required level. And finally, there is a loudspeaker. Loudspeaker again converts electrical signal back into sound system. So I think why I took this system, because this is common to all, because in everywhere we are using a PA system, a sound system, public addressing system. In this, there must be a microphone and a loudspeaker. If you see the purpose of a loudspeaker, as I told you once, it converts sound waves into electrical signal. So anything which converts energy from one form to another form is nothing but a transducer. So in a public addressing system, you can say there are two transducers. One is microphone, which converts energy in one form, that is sound wave, converting it to electrical form. Now come to the speaker side, loudspeaker side. Here again, it is a transducer. It converts electrical signal into sound wave. So what do you mean by a transducer? A transducer is nothing but a device which converts one form of energy into another form. Now, sensors and transducers. Sensors and transducers are both devices which react to change in physical quantity in their surrounding. Transducers are sometimes referred to as sensors and vice versa. This can make telling the difference difficult, but they are different devices with a different characteristics. So my first aim is to differentiate between sensors and transducers. So my first target is to tell you what's the difference between sensor and a transducer. Now, let me show you some examples. See, first of all, I want to tell you today, I'm going to give you only a broad idea, not the detailed study that we will do in the coming classes. So first, what I'm going to show you is actually a thermistor. Here, there are three types of thermistor I've shown. Everything is same, one probe type, disc type, and hole type. These are nothing but a resistance. So a thermistor is a resistor whose resistance change with a small change in the measured temperature. It is a resistance made up of semiconducting material. As all of you know, there are three types of material: conductors, insulators, and semiconductors are in between these conductors and semiconductor. So these thermistors are made up of that type of semiconductor material, and its main function is to convert temperature into another form. You got my point. So here, this is thermistor. So thermistor alone cannot do anything. Even before anything, if you check, it will show you only resistance. Even after with some temperature, it will show you only resistance. That means before and after, it shows only resistance only. Then if you connect this into a circuit, that is I shown in the next figure. So here, this terminal to this terminal is nothing but our thermistor. Balance are all some extra connection. Using this connection, suppose some fixed temperature, this much E supply is there, this much resistance is there, so that it will give you some deflection, current deflection. Whenever the temperature increases, so what will happen? Either this resistance will increase or the resistance will decrease. If anything happen to this, what will happen to this calibrate, this meter? It will either decrease or decrease. So with additional these facilities, now this become a transducer. So if you check this alone, that this thermistor is nothing but a sensor. But if you add this additional circuitry, it become a transducer. Let me explain one more example. This is nothing but a microphone in a public addressing system. It is actually made up of two parallel plate capacities. So these, the first one, we call it as black back plate, and there is one more plate, it's another plate. This plate is a diaphragm. Diaphragm in the sense, it is very flexible to move here and there. So as all of you know, these two are parallel plate. That means parallel plate capacitors. In between, there is a dielectric air. So whenever sound waves comes, these diaphragm fluctuate. That is showing in the bottom. When a vacuum comes, diaphragm may come, on the curvature may be on the upwards. When some force comes, this will shrink inside. So accordingly, whenever the area between these two plates changes, the value of capacitance changes. So for that, in order to take that value, change in values of capacitance, we need some additional circuitry. That is what showing here, a voltage source is here, some another add-on additional circuitry is here. So if everything together, it become a transducer. So microphone is a transducer, but in this, these two, that means a parallel plate capacitor is the first sensing element or a sensor. And now with this, I think you understood, a sensor just senses, that's all. But in order to convert this change in capacitance into some electrical signal, we need some additional circuitry. So sensor, that means these two capacitance, along with this additional circuitry, it become a transducer. Now I think all of you understood what's the difference between a capacitor as well as a transducer. Now one more example I want to show you is regarding thermocouple. Or before that, I think we can go for the definition of sensors. What do you mean by a sensor? Sensor is a device that detects a change in a physical condition and turns into a signal which can be measured or recorded. I think all of you understood. Sensor is a device that detects a change in any physical condition and turns it into a signal which can be measured or recorded. Whereas a transducer uses transduction principle. Transduction is a technical word. Transduction principle to convert a specified measurement. Measurement means input signal into a usable output. What is actually transduction and measurement, I will explain. You can see the process of converting the measurement from one form to another is called transduction. Whereas the primary input quantity that is to be measured is called a measurement. So the primary input quantity in the previous case, the primary input quantity was sound, that is known as measurement, and the entire process by which the change in capacitance is converted into electrical signal is called a transduction. So in short, this is a slide which I want to show you. Look, in this, you can see that the sensor is having only a sensing element, whereas a transducer is having a sensing element and a transduction element. Only then it become a transducer. I think at least you understood. So every sensor, in every transducer, at least one sensor would be there. But I think you understood what I mean by, so in this case, you can see this parallel plate capacitor are our sensor, whereas the balance circuitry along with this sensor, it become a transducer. Similarly, in the thermistor case, this figure is the sensor, that is thermistor is a sensor, and along with thermistor, if you make some more arrangements or circuit and all, so that a temperature difference can be measured or can be used for some other purpose, then it become a transducer. Now, one more type of transducer I will show you, that is thermocouple. Thermocouple, I think all of you know, it's two different types joined in one junction. See, a thermocouple is a sensor that measures temperature. It consists of two different types of metal joined together at one end. When the junction of one of the two metals is heated or cooled, a voltage is created that can be correlated back to the temperature. Now, see here, there are two junctions. One is this junction, this is a hot junction, and this one is another junction, this is a cold junction. If there is a temperature difference between this junction and this junction, then there will be a potential created across this. So in this thermocouple, that means in this sensor, actually in one shot, it is converting heat into directly voltage. No need of any additional circuit here. So there are some sensors that sensors even can transform one form of energy into another form directly without the help of any other circuitry. That is an example. Thermocouple is an example for that. So here, these are two different wires joined in one junction, and we kept at hot junction here. The other junction we kept at cold. Other junction in the sense, the other two end of the wires are connected in this. Are kept in the same cold condition. So between these two, there will be a voltage. That voltage you can measure here. So here, the temperature difference is directly converted into electricity. So there are, what I want to tell you, there are two different types of sensors we can say. In these types of sensor, in order to get electrical signal, we need a transduction element. Similarly, this one also we need a transduction element, but there are certain sensors which does not require any external power supply or anything. By itself, it can generate or it can transform heat into electrical signal. So these are some of the examples which I want to tell you regarding sensors and transducers. I feel all of you get some idea now regarding sensor and transducer and the difference between sensor and a transducer. Now come to the next topic, that is regarding classification. There are, I think, am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, audible.
I can continue in this way. No, I can continue in this way. Now come to classification. There are many types of classification regarding sensors and transducers. There is active and passive transducer, analog and digital transducer, transducers and inverse transducer, primary and secondary transducer, then transducers on the basis of method used for transduction or on the basis of the measurement, that means input signal, and so on and so on. But I gone through your syllabus and I found that the first two are there in your syllabus, that is active and passive transducers and analog and digital transducers. Being a computer student, digital transducers are very important for you. Nowadays, you know, in human, we are using a number of senses, like even blood pressure, blood flow, all this. In order to control all this, we are using transducers, which is actually digital transducer, so that you can connect directly to your computer and you can get. So this is very important area for you, digital. Even all the transducers are important, and especially digital transducer is there in your syllabus, and you have to study it very carefully. But come to this, transducers, inverse transducer, primary and secondary transducer are nothing is there in your syllabus. But the balance of your paper is based on these, that transducers on the basis of the method used for transduction and on the basis of the measurement. These are the other topics. So we'll discuss these things one by one by one. Now we'll see active and passive transducers. What do you mean by active? Active transducers are defined as those transducers which do not require any external power source to generate the equivalent output. Like an example of thermocouple. Here we don't want any external source or power. Even without any external help, it can convert or it can even generate voltage by itself. Such transducers are known as active transducers. So, and once again, I want to tell you, active transducers are defined as those transducers which do not require any external power source to generate the equivalent output. That means they are self-generating transducers. Examples are thermocouples and piezoelectric crystal transducers. Here also there is one more type transducer. Anyway, I'm not going to much deep into this. Here, this is what, there are two electrodes here. In between, it's a piezoelectric material. If you apply a force here, directly you will get a voltage here. Or if you apply voltage here, it will deform. Its shape will change. Or maybe its height will reduce or a length will increase. Some sort of change will be there. That type of materials are known as piezoelectric material. So piezoelectric transducer is made up of piezoelectric crystal. And apart from that, there are two electrodes. So if you apply a force here, due to this force, there will be deformation of the crystal, and accordingly, we'll get a voltage here. So for these type of transducers, we don't want to give any additional power supply. Such type, or they are self-generating. They generate the corresponding electricity by themselves. Such transducers are known as active transducers. Now, come to passive transducers. Passive transducers are defined as those transducers that require external power supply for their operation of conversion of a physical quantity into output. So these type of transducer, passive transducer, in order to work this, we have to give additional power supply. So you can see in a microphone, if it is to be, if it has to work, you have to give some battery inside it, inside the microphone, or some voltage source must be there. With that, with the help of this additional source only, this can work. Such type of transducers are known as passive transducers. These are another examples. This is a potentiometer here. This originally, this is a resistance with a variable head here. If you move up and down with respect to this terminal, the resistance will vary. But in order to get some output from here, you have to give a supply here. So these two are not self-generating. Not only these two, there are many such examples. So if the transducers that require external power supply for their operation of conversion of physical quantity into output, then that type of transducers are called passive transducers. I think all of you followed what I mean by an active transducer or a passive transducer. Now we'll go to analog and digital transducer. There are again one more type of classification, that is analog and digital. A analog transducer converts the input physical quantity into analog output, which is a continuous function of time. You can see this again an example of thermocouple. I already told regarding thermocouple. Now see, in this pot we kept liquid and we are boiling it, that means we are heating it. So this end the temperature is high compared to the other end. Now naturally there will be a voltage here. Nature of that voltage will be like this. That means it is time varying signal. That means whenever you increase the temperature, its value will increase. Whenever you reduce the temperature, its value will decrease. Such type, that means it is always continuous with the time. Such type of a continuous time varying signals are known as, if the transducer produce an output with a time varying output, then that type of signals, that type of transducers are known as analog transducers. Now come to digital transducer. A digital transducer converts the input physical quantity into digital form, that is in the form of pulses or having logic 0 or 1. This is an example that light sensor used to produce a digital signal is an example of a digital. Here you can see, I will explain this. This is a rotating disc. This is a rotating shaft on which there is an aluminium disc. Rotating disc is there. And on this disc, there are so many holes here. And here, this is a transmitter. I mean, it's a light emitting diode. It emits light continuously. But whenever a hole comes, at that time only, this light will transform, or this light will move to this side. Or without hole, the disc is having another, say, in a disc, there is only one hole. So when that holes come, this light will transmit to this side. Other times, it blocks the light. So whenever it passes through, or whenever you rotate this, when the disc with a hole with the disc comes at this end, it will get one signal here. So whenever it gets a pulse here, it gives you reading 1. Then if it rotates continuously, so again whenever another hole comes, it will give you 2. That means the output will be like this. Each time you are getting the same magnitude, but the signals are discrete. So a digital transducer converts the input physical quantity into digital form, that is in the form of pulses having logic 0 or 1. That means either yes or no, nothing else. That means whenever the hole comes, it transmits a light here. We can say yes, light came. All the other time, no light. So it gives only yes or no, or we will call it as logic 0 or 1. Such type of sensors are known as digital sensor, or such type of transducers are known as digital transducers. Now, in the balance, I don't want to discuss here because it is not there in your syllabus. That means transducers and inverse transducers, primary and secondary transducers are not there. Then directly we'll go to the next one. That is on the basis of the method of transduction. On the basis of the method of transduction, they are three types: resistive type, capacitive type, and inductive type. See, balance of your first module is with this only. I mean, the first module, first half is only introduction. Then the second half contains your resistive, capacitive and inductive transducers. That means the transducers based on the principle of transduction. So in that, first we'll start with the resistive transducer. Transducers based on the principle of variation in resistance are generally termed as resistance transducers. Once again, I will tell you, transducers based on the principle of variation in resistance are generally termed as resistance transducers. Then I'll explain, as all of you, I feel all of you know this basic equation. Resistance is given by rho L by A, where rho is a resistivity, L is a length, and A is the area of cross section of the wire. Now, this resistivity is highly dependent on temperature. Length, like in a potentiometer, you can vary the length. Even there are methods by using which you can even change the area. Now, out of these three, if anything you change, then what will happen? Resistance value will change. If you increase area of cross section, the resistance will decrease. If you increase length, then resistance will increase. If you change temperature, then resistance will change. So based on this principle, that means principle based on either rho or L or A, you have to change. If you are doing and if you are creating a sensor or a transducer, then that type of transistor is known as a resistive transducer. The examples are thermistors and potentiometer, which I already shown to you. That's why I don't want to show it again. So this is regarding resistive transducer. I think this equation is a fundamental equation, and I think all of you studied it at least in the 12th class, maybe physics, you have to study it. Now come to capacitive. They are the capacitors with variable capacity. Again, you know about the parallel plate capacitors. There are two parallel plates separated by a dielectric. It will form a capacitor. Then you have to give a potential, positive potential here or negative potential here. Then what will happen? It store charges. If you connect a positive side of a cell to one side and negative to other side, what will happen? By interaction, it will store, say, positive charge here and naturally oppositely negative charge. But there is no way by which it can transfer from here to here through inside, because it is filled with the it is filled with the dielectric. So that how much charge it can store, that is given by capacitance C. So capacitance C is given by epsilon naught epsilon R into surface area divided by distance between these two plates. Like in the resistor, here also we can vary the capacitance by varying any parameter, where S is the electrode surface area, this area, then D is the electrode gap distance, that means between these two, and epsilon dielectric constant of the dielectric, whatever dielectric you are using here, and dielectric constant of vacuum is epsilon naught, and relative dielectric constant of the dielectric is given by epsilon R. If you can change any of these parameter, you can get variation in the capacitor. So as I told you in the microphone, there we are changing the distance between these two. That means D only we are changing in the microphone. So this way, if you do some changes according to these, and if you can get a change in the capacitance value, then we will get a capacitive transducer. So they are capacitors with variable capacity. So this shows the basic construction of a capacitor, etc. Now, the third one regarding that is inductive transducer. Inductive transducer is nothing, it's simple transformer. It's nothing but a transformer. Here, I think all of you know about transformer. This is actually primary of the transformer. These are the two secondary coils of the transformer. Here you can see, without this connection, we can say this is one coil, then this is another coil. Both the coils, secondary coils, are equal. Then it is connected in the opposite direction. That means this red color shows, suppose this is a plus side, then other end is minus side. Similarly, for this coil, this is plus side, this another is minus side. Now you can see here, this minus is connected to the minus. That means these two coils are connected opposite direction. I can show you here an example. Here there I connected two cells here. One a cell with a 10 volt, another is a cell with a 5 volt. Now in this connection, here you can see the connection negative. Here the positive is connected to the negative. Again it is like this. In this case, we can say these two cells are connected in series, and you will get the resultant value, that is 15 volt. Whereas in the second figure, the two cells are connected in the opposite direction. That means here minus is connected to minus and That's why the resultant will be difference between these two. That means only 5 volt. 10 minus 5, you will get only 5 volt. The same way, you can see here, this is plus, then this is minus. That minus is now connected to the minus. That means the secondary side coils are connected in the opposite direction so that your output will be E1 minus E2, resultant. And your input is E input. So whenever you give an input, and if you keep the core exactly at the center, you can say that here it will produce same voltage, and here also it will produce same voltage, and net voltage will be zero. That experiment portion is shown here. So this is the primary coil here. This from here to here, it is primary coil, and this is a secondary coil. This also a secondary coil, and they are connected in the opposite direction. So whenever this core is in its center position, what will happen? Net voltage will be zero. Now, using some method, suppose you move this core downwards, then what will happen? The voltage produced here will be less and voltage produced here will be more. That means if you move this core downwards, then voltage generated at E2 will be more, whereas because the voltage link, the flux linked with this coil is less, so here induced EMF in this one will be less. So your net effect, that means E1 minus E2 will be minus. So with this, we can understand our coil is moving downwards. Now suppose you move this coil upwards, then what will happen? If this core is moved upwards, not coil, this core, if you move upwards, then what will happen? Maximum flux linked with this coil, and here you will get maximum voltage, whereas here the voltage will be less, and your E1 will be more, and E2 will be less. The net difference, E1 minus E2 will be plus. Or you can see this pointer, this is center zero pointer. This pointer either moves in this direction or moves in this direction. So based on that, you can say that this core is moved up or down. And that means using this, even you can convert a displacement, a movement into a corresponding voltage. So these type of transducers are known as inductive transducers. They work based on the principle of inductor. So these are one examples from resistance, inductance and capacitance. So there are three methods I told you: resistive method, capacitive method, inductive method. And your first module, the balance portion of the first module is with this resistive, capacitive and inductive transducers. In that I gave only a basic idea, but there are many resistive transducers like thermistor, RTD, then strain gauge, many are there. Even capacitive transducer, there are level transducer, then microphone, etc. Many are there. Even in this inductive case, there will be LVDT, that is linear variable differential transformer, then RVDT, rotary variable differential transformer. Many are there in your syllabus. All these topics will be taken in the coming classes. Today, what I want to give you is only a broad idea. So I think almost in the first module, whatever topics there, I just given you an idea. Now come to the balance, that is classification on the basis of the measurand. Measurand means input signal. Input signals. Input signal, as I told you in the previous, it may be sound, it may be temperature, it may be pressure, it may be level, it may be flow, it may be radiation and so on. There are many things, but in your syllabus, these two, like effect of temperature and pressure, are given in the second module. So second module is with the transducers using input signal as temperature and input signal as pressure, whereas the output will be always electrical. So thermal type, that means temperature varying transducers like our thermocouples, etc. are coming in the second module. Similarly, pressure variable transducers, input will be pressure. Using that pressure is converted into electricity. They are coming into in the second module. Whereas in the third module, it is level. That means you can measure the height, flow, etc. That comes in the third module. So third module is filled with your transducers with the input as level, input as flow, then output will be electrical. So level transducer will be there, flow transducer will be there. These are all coming in the third module. Whereas in the fourth and final module, it is with the sound, force and radiation. That means, as I told you, in a microphone, sound is converted into electricity. Similarly, force or torque can be converted into electricity. Radiation can be converted into electricity. That is coming in the final module. I think I gave you an overall idea regarding your syllabus. First thing, I want to tell you what you mean by sensor or what you mean by a transducer. Is it same? No, both are different. But in all the transducers, there will be sensors, and without sensor and transduction, a transducer is not possible. Then in your first module, after this introduction, the balance will be resistance based on resistance, inductance and capacitance transducers. And next day, it will be like thermal pressure, and next one, next module will be covered with level flow and sound, and level and flow, and the final module will be based on, that means input will be sound, then converting into electrical signal. Now, come to the characteristics. The sensors, like measurement system, have two general parameters. One is static parameter, the other one is dynamic parameter. So all sensors or transducers that are having, they are comes under measurement system, they have two general parameters. One is static, that means stationary value, another one dynamic, that means while on measurement. So there are two types of parameters. Now come to static parameters. The performance characteristic which measure slowly varying or unvarying data and thereby indicate the response of the device are known as static characteristics. So what do you mean by static characteristics? The performance characteristic which measure slowly varying or even unvarying data and thereby indicate the response of the device are known as static characteristics. The examples are accuracy, precision, resolution, sensitivity, etc., etc. There are many such characteristics. So, first of all, I want to tell you, sensors or transducers are having two different types of characteristics. One is static, another one is dynamic. Static means performance characteristics which measure slowly varying or even unvarying data, thereby indicate the response of the device are known as static characteristics. The examples are accuracy, precision, resolution, and etc. Now come to dynamic characteristics. The characteristics which indicate the response of the device that measure time varying quantities in which the input varies with the time and so does the output are known as dynamic characteristics. The characteristics which indicate the response of a device that measure time varying quantities and in which the input varies and so the output also varies. Such characteristics are known as dynamic characteristics. The two important dynamic characteristics are speed of response determined by time lag and fidelity are the two important characteristics. Now we'll discuss each one. First one is accuracy. Accuracy, I think all of you know, accuracy is defined as a degree of closeness or exactness of a measured value compared to the true value of the quantity measured. That means accuracy is given by xm minus xt by xt, where xm means measured value, actually true value, the actual value, divided by actual value into 100 will give you the accuracy. Then what do you mean by accuracy? Accuracy is defined as a degree of closeness or exactness of a measured value compared to the true value of the quantity being measured. Now come to precision. Precise means sharply or clearly defined. It is, again we can say, it is close to repeatability. If you do a number of measurements with the same input, same condition, we should get the same value. Then it is a measure of degree up to which repeated readings in a group of measurement are similar. It's a measure of the degree up to which repeated readings in a group of measurement are similar, provided they are measured under the same condition. They are measured under the same condition. So it is close to repeatability. Even if you do 10 times, I have to get the same result for the same input and same condition. Now, resolution. It is defined as the smallest incremental change in the input that would produce a detectable change in the output. So I think all of you understood what you mean by resolution. Resolution, see, you know, even in an analog weighing machine, with a change of 100 gram or something, it won't show. It will, but whereas in a digital case, it may even show 50 grams difference also. So resolution means it is defined as the smallest incremental change in the input that would produce a detectable change in the output. So with a small incremental change, say even with a 100, if you take an example, you take the case of a multimeter or a voltmeter, a thousand volt measuring voltmeter, if you use, and if you give only 0.5 volt, it cannot show anything. So that is why I'm telling a smallest incremental change in the input that can produce a detectable change in the output, that is known as resolution. Then come to sensitivity. It is a ratio of incremental output to incremental input. Suppose you change, you increase the input by a small quantity and your output also increases by a small quantity, take the ratio that gives sensitivity. If the equipment is sensitive, very sensitive, even for a small change in input, it will give you a corresponding change in the output. Then come to static error. Static error is defined as a difference between the measured value and the true value. Error is defined as a difference between the measured value and the true value. The error may be equal to or less than the value given by accuracy. When this error difference is constant, the error is said to be static error. So I think, see, error is defined as a difference between the measured value and the true value. As I told you in the beginning, like accuracy, it is measured value minus true value, and if the error may be equal to or less than its maximum value, or it is predicted by the accuracy. When this error difference is constant, the error is said to be static error. So these are some of the examples of static characteristics. Come to dynamic characteristics. The speed of response determined by the time lag is one of the dynamic characteristics. You know, the various factors such as mass and capacitance cause slowness in the device that are used to measure time varying quantity. So various factors such as mass of an item or capacitive effect cause the slowness of the device that are used to measure time varying quantity. This results in delay of the response, or this results in a delay of the output. This delayed response is known as measuring lag. And the quickness with which an instrument responds to changes in the measured quantity is known as speed of response. So speed of response or measuring lag, these comes under dynamic characteristic. It say if you give an input, the output may come after a little delay. That type of delay is known as measuring lag, and by which the speed of response may be reduced. Then the last one is actually fidelity, the characteristics. Here, the quality of reproducing faithful values is known as fidelity. Or it is defined as the ability of an instrument to indicate the changes in the measured quantity. So these are some of the static and dynamic characteristics. Then there is one more topic that is known as requirement of a sensor. Again, you know, requirement, I didn't put any slides for that, but you know, the requirement of a sensor, we know it must be highly accurate, it must be there must be good precision, then good resolution, good sensitivity, less error. These are the requirements. So the same thing is repeating in your that area also. So almost most of the topic in the first half module is over. I think all of you got some idea regarding this sensors and transducers, and we'll take the time for some discussion. And I want, before going to the next topic, I want to clear. I feel I went little fast, so if you have any doubts, you can ask now. Hello, whether I went very fast,
no,
or whether I have to repeat?
It was very clear. And
have you followed it or not?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, towards the participants, if you have any doubts or need any clarification for today's topic, you can ask now. Hello, towards the participants, if you have any queries, you can ask now. Please unmute your mic and you can ask now. I think it was a very clear explanation and very brief. So if you need any clarification towards today's topic, you can ask now. Yes, Sri Vidya. Sri Vid.
Hello. The syllabus already changed.
Hello, sir.
There is no doubt, sir. Please continue.
Sir,
please continue, sir. There is no doubt up to this.
Okay, towards the participants, if you are asking anything, just convey your name and designation, please. Then ask your questions. Can you just tell your name and designation if you want, then ask, please. This is only the introductory part and an outlook towards the entire syllabus. Then in coming sessions, we will concentrate more on each modules and topics. Okay. If anybody want any queries, you can ask now.
Now, if you don't want, if you're not asking something, let me ask something. What do you mean by resistivity? Have you studied it or not? See, I explained there are in a resist. This is a simple thing. So resistance equal to rho L by A. L is the length of the conductor. A is the area of cross section. Rho is the resistivity. Now, because you don't have any doubt, let me ask one thing: whether you got it or not, I want to know. What do you mean by rho? What do you mean by resistivity? See, we can simply define resistivity from here itself. You can see L is the length of the conductor, A is the area of cross section. Now suppose I want to make a cube. Maybe I want to find out the resistivity of a gold, resistivity of gold or resistivity of silver or resistivity of copper, whatever thing I want to find out it. Then what to do? You make a cube of that. You got my point now? With length equal to 1 meter and area of cross section, that means this width as well as this height equal to 1 meter, 1 meter. Then you just simply substitute into this equation. Then what is the value? R equal to length is 1, then area 1 into 1, that means 1 again. So what will be that equal to? R equal to rho. That means resistivity is nothing but the resistance of a meter cube of that material. Have you got it or not? Anybody tell this whether you understood or not? So if you want to find out the resistivity of gold, how can you measure the resistivity of gold? Resistivity of gold in the whole world, there may be only once it is measured, and that value we have to keep it constant. So you can see we have to create a meter cube of gold like this. Then by using a precision meter, you have to measure the value of this resistance of this block from the opposite ends, so that you can find out the resistivity of that copper. And you need to measure only once, and that value will be fixed for copper or gold throughout its life. And the only condition, it should not change the temperature. If the temperature changes, resistivity will change. That means resistivity is highly dependent on temperature. I think all of you understood. That means a meter cube, you make, if you want to find out the resistivity of copper, you construct a meter cube of that material, like in this form. Then take resistance value from the opposite ends. These two are the terminals for measuring the resistance. Whatever you are going to get, that is nothing but its resistance, resistivity. That means resistance will become equal to resistivity when length equal to 1 and area of cross section is equal to 1. I think you understood. Now, come to the next topic. This is something related to piezoelectric transducer. This is there in your syllabus. Anyway, my other next teachers will take this class, but still I want to just tell you about this. Piezoelectric crystal. There is one piezoelectric crystal. So this is a simple piezoelectric crystal. And here I didn't give any supply to this. That means supply is zero. In that case, that crystal will stay as it is. Whenever you give a supply like plus here and minus here, what will happen? This will elongate. That means the tension or the force will be in this side, so that the crystal will elongate. Similarly, if you say this plus minus, if you make it in the opposite direction, minus here and plus here, then what will happen? This will shrink or compression. Now, you think in the opposite direction. That means there is no supply here. But using some external force, if you shrink this, then what will happen? Some voltage will be created here. You got my point? Or if you elongate this, or then what will happen? Some reverse voltage will be created here. The crystals or the transducers, using this principle, there are certain materials, that type of materials only we can use, that and the transducer creating using these type of material are known as piezoelectric transducers, and these sensors, even these are sensors that directly give supply. Now, being computer science students, my request is you have to study digital transducers more thoroughly, because in all human, even nowadays the human or biomedical area, a lot of sensors are using, they are all digital sensors. Using that, you can even measure the blood pressure or blood flow. Many such things are there. Even in signal processing area, even in image processing area, we are using a lot of sensors, and these sensors are all directly related to your computer student. So don't think it's an unwanted subject. No, it's very important subject and one of the core subject of your area, and you must study it. So I feel I gave you an introduction, as a little introduction, and in the next classes we'll very seriously or very in depth we will go to the classes. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your valuable session. Now it's time for students to ask the questions. If you have any doubts, you can ask. Participants, if you have any queries, you can ask. You can also mention the queries in the comment box.
See, you can note down my mail ID. If you have any doubts, even in the future, you can ask, send the queries through my mail. I have written my mail ID here. I think you can see now.
Yes, sir.
dr.josephtharattil@jacc.ac.in.
Okay, sir.
I'm professor in Electronics and Communication Department, Jyothi Engineering College. So once again, thanks to the coordinators for inviting me as a resource.